Can everybody hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. I can hear you.
Well, just like Megan said, I'm a research scientist at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. And as scientists, we often go to regular scientific meetings to present our works, our findings, and get criticism, ideas from other investigators that will benefit our work. So in July 2019, I was invited by the Society for Mycosal Immunology to give a presentation in Brisbane, Queensland, in Australia. I've never been to Australia, so I was excited to go there and explore the outdoors, despite my son's advice not to do that because he's watching a lot of nature documentaries, and he told me how many deadly and poisonous animals and plants live in Australia. So death will be lurking around every corner. So I went anyway and explored the outback after the meeting. So let me see. So these are the things I'd like to talk about today. I'd like to give you an idea why I'm breeding and keeping Rhinocentrus ornatus. I'd like to give credits and indicate the sources for my talk. I'll show you where you can find rats, show pictures of the native habitat, the fish we collected, and also how I breed those fish. The name Rhinocentrus ornatus, I looked up what it could mean. I found that Rhinos means slender, centrum, meaning thorn or spine, referring to a slender and flexible rays of spinous dorsal fins, and ornatus means decorated, presumably referring to the two rows of scales with black margins along the middle of the fish. So in other words, a slender body-shaped fish with thorny spinal dorsal fins and a body that's decorated in two rows of scales that are surrounded by black margins. And when you look at some of these fish, you can see that this is actually the case. I breed and keep these fish mainly because there is such a variety in colors that you can find. It's still considered one species, although several lineages have been described, but it's at the moment still considered one species. But the color variety is really great. So it's between the different locations colors vary, but even within one collection point, like, you know, a particular creek like Snapper Creek, there can be multiple color forms. There's typically one dominant color form, and then there is either one or other multiple rare color forms. Those rare color forms might be more flashy, and that could be the reason why they're more likely to be predated and therefore are less abundant in the wild. But I think in the hobby and when you breed this fish, we have a chance to select for those rare color forms. These are typically the more colorful ones because there is no predation in our tanks. So I'd like to acknowledge the sources for my talk first. I use this wonderful edition of Fishes of Sahul that was prepared by Adrian Tappan and Leo O'Reilly. It's entirely dedicated to the ornate rainbow fish. For people who don't know, Fishes of Sahul is the newsletter for ANGFA that gets put out every other month. ANGFA stands for Australian New Guinea Fishes Association. So if you care and if you're interested about native fish from Australia or New Guinea, I highly recommend becoming a member of ANGFA. And so you will get the newsletter, Fishes of Sahul, delivered to your house and also electronically. There's actually a membership for people in North America. It costs like $30 or $35, so it's very affordable. So I used some of the maps and some of the photos that are published in this particular edition of Visions of Sahul for my talk. I'd also like to give credit to Günter Schmider. Most of the pictures that are in that particular Visions of Sahul article that I was mentioning, they were taken by Günter Schmider. Günter Schmider is a naturalist, writer, and wildlife photographer of Australia's natural wonders, including freshwater fish, amphibians, reptiles, and birds. So if you're interested in rainbow fish and native fish from Australia or New Guinea, it is hard to imagine that you have not seen pictures and photos from Günter Schmider. I indicated his website link on the upper right corner. And on the left, you can see his website, and you can order from his books that he has published. One of the books that I thought I would highlight here is a book that has like 350 images of rainbow fish and other native fish from Australia. I was fortunate to be able to visit with Günter after my scientific meeting for one day, and I was able to see his setup for his photography and also his art studio. And he even showed me a draft of a book that he was working on at that time. It was on the regal rainbow fish, or Melanotania trifasciata, which is now just recently published, just another wonderful book. I really had a blast visiting with him. We sat on the balcony, and native birds like parrots and lorikeets were visiting, and it was just fascinating. So Günter gave me permission to use his photos for my presentation today. Last but not least, I'd like to thank Lee O'Reilly. He is the reason why I'm giving this talk, really. He took me fishing to Tin Can Bay, the area we'll be seeing pictures of pretty soon. He is a retired pilot from the Army. And he gave me some information about his hobby. So I put together a brief bio for what he's doing with regard to native Australian fish. He has been breeding Australian rainbow fish for about 20 years now. And for the last 15 years, he has specialized in rats. He currently keeps and breeds about 20 locations of the most colorful rats. And he's planning to reduce those different locations to something like 10, but he will then breed multiple color morphs for some of the locations. There's sometimes more than one. He currently runs, he recently moved to a new house, and he currently runs about 60 tubs that range in size from 100 to 200 liters. For those of you who are not as familiar with the metric system, I also indicated the size in gallons. He also has two round ponds that contain like 2000 liters, and 12 IBCs that each have about 1000 liters in there. IBC stands for intermediate bulk containers. He's planning to level more ground on his property to be able to place another 20 IBCs. So where can you find the rats? When you look on the map, they're predominantly found on the east coast of Australia. And if you're familiar with where Brisbane is on the east coast, you realize that Brisbane is dead center of the distribution range of the rats. So I'm gonna zoom in now on the map on that area. You can see Brisbane there. Let me make sure that I have the, can you see my laser pointer? So here is Brisbane.
Yeah.
And this is along the coast. You can see that there's many locations where one can find rats. Up to now, there have been five lineages described for this species, and I'm showing here representatives of each of the lineages in photos. For some of the lineages, there have been natural hybrids found. It's possible that over time, some of the lineages will be described as separate species, but as of now, this fish is still considered one species. So I'm going to focus in on the frame here in A to further look at where we went fishing. So you can see the various locations where one can find rats. I highlighted the locations that we visited in red. So we went to Tiwa Creek, we went to Snapper Creek, we went to Puna Creek, and we also visited Carland Creek and Sears Creek, although we were not able to fish there because those areas are a national park, so you can't fish in those locations. So one of the most fascinating parts of my trip to Australia was the fact that I was able to see the natural habitat of where these fish are coming from. When you breed this fish, you always wonder, you know, how does the environment look like? This is how Tiwa Creek looks. More pictures of Tiwa Creek. So the climate around Brisbane is subtropical. So that means it's not super hot, but it's also much more temperate than you're used to in Wisconsin. I was there in July, so July would be winter, would be midwinter in Australia. And nighttime low temperatures were in the upper 40s, lower 50s, and daytime highs were in the mid to upper 70s. So for us Wisconsinites, this is kind of t-shirt and shorts weather. But that's the winter, and the fish are able to survive these temperatures easily. So the way we fished was by using collapsible bait traps. And here's Leo putting in some fishing burley. People that fish in Australia, they also use other baits like roast chicken or dried cat food or Vegemite. But Leo likes this particular bait because it gives off a scent, so it attracts the fish and it's clean to handle. You can see that the bait traps float. So we set out multiple traps in different water holes and then circled those and visit them periodically to see if any fish were caught in there. So this is one of the wild fish that we caught from Tiwa Creek. This is one of my own fish. I can show you a picture of the same fish taken by Günther Schmider. So the front half of the fish is bronze colored, and then the back half is red orange. So very attractive fish. So this is a fish that exists in this color form at Tiwa Creek. It's not a rare color form. It's a fish that's very abundant in that location. We also fished at Snapper Creek. These are pictures from that area. And Snapper Creek is a different collection point than Tiwa Creek. There is one color form that dominates in this particular creek. It's the black color form that has blue iridescent fins. And very rare, you can find fish that are of a green color morph, or fish that are a red color morph. Leah calls these fish one percenters because 1% or less of the population in that creek will have these rare color forms. So here's another picture of the green color morph versus the black, the dominant color morph. And this is the second rare color morph, the red morph. Leo gave me, I think, 11 fish from that location. And of these 11 fish, it turned out that I got two females and the rest were males. And he gave me one male that was of the red color morph. And that's the fish that you see in these photos here. In both photos, you can see that the fish is in breeding mode. So it can turn on the breeding stripe that goes from the tip of the mouth to the first dorsal fin. So a very attractive color morph. I have been exclusively breeding with this male and the two females that I got, and I'm selecting for this red color morph because I think it's a highly attractive color morph. So here's a video of that particular fish that Leo gave me. So it's the red color morph. At this point in time, the fish wasn't in breeding mode. So it wasn't particularly vibrantly red. And the scales were also not particularly, you know, showing the margins. But you can see how nice this fish looks. I generated an F1 generation with this red fish and the blue females. And then I picked the females that had red tails and crossed them again with this male. And now I have F2 fish that have even more red on the body. There are other fish that you can find in creeks that harbor rats. So for example, there's Melanotania dubulae. So these are dubulae from Snapper Creek, very attractive rainbow fish. And also what you can find are blue eyes. These are not rainbow fish, they're a separate species. They're pseudomogills, in particular pseudomogill mellis. It's a tiny, small fish. It is considered endangered and threatened in Australia. So if you catch fish like that, you're obligated to let them go and not take them home. And for sure, you cannot bring them out of the country either. But we caught some in the locations that we fished. A very bright, a very vibrant fish. Tiny, but a jewel. We also visited Ceres Creek. It's probably one of the best known locations for this fish. Most people have that particular location in their tanks. It's a national park, so you can't fish there anymore. The water is crystal clear with a sandy bottom. You can actually see there is even a big catfish down here. You can see the fish very well. There's a boardwalk leading right up to the creek, and you can sit on this boardwalk and watch the fish. You can see the rats, you can see the catfish and other native fish in there. You can see the little end of the boardwalk and just beautiful pristine water. So the most of the fish, the dominant color form that you find in Ceres Creek, those fish are blue. And rarely you find a fish that has a little bit of red on the tail, and even more rare, you can find fish that have red on the body. So Leo, a while back, he auctioned some fish from an anther meeting. I think he started out with 6 blue fish. And he started breeding those fish. And in the second generation, he occasionally had a fish with a red tail. He selected the fish with the red tails and bred them with each other. And over time, he was able to go from an entirely blue fish to an entirely red fish, like you can see in this image here. So this is one of the fascinating facets of these fish that, you know, that fascinate me in breeding them, because you can selectively bring out colors in a population of fish that is normally hidden if you just look at the natural distribution of the color forms. I actually received Sirius Creek rats even before I went on a trip to Australia. I got some eggs from Sirius Creek fish from Gary Lang in fall 2017. And from the fish that I hatched, I think I had two males of red tails and the rest were blue. I, just like Leo, I selected the red fish. And after a few generations, I had fish last year, this is one of my last year breeders, that had quite a bit of red. So probably half or even two thirds of the body was red. Here's another fish showing the breeding stripe during courtship, the red breeding stripe that goes from the tip of the nose to the first dorsal fin. We also fished at the Puna Creek, which is a slightly different habitat. So in July, it was the dry season, so the fish were concentrated in water holes. And Leah told me that during the rainy season, those water holes will rise, and there will actually be creeks, or water will be running over the entire landscape. So fish will have a chance to distribute and spread out in the larger environment where the creeks are located. So the fish that you can find in Puna Creek look like this. This is not one of the dominant color forms. This is what Leo calls a one percenter. This particular color form has been described as the precox form in analogy to Melanotonia precox that have a blue body and red fins. So this is one of the rare color forms. From this rare precox morph, even more rare morphs have been selected, like this red form that has been bred out from the precox morph. And this is how we collected the fish. We put them in bags with fresh water from the creeks. Leah always put a little bit of salt, which seems to aid in the transport and survival of the fish when you bring them home. And everything was kept in styrofoam boxes, so the fish wouldn't overheat, although it wasn't very warm at that time. It was in the mid-70s. We also passed Carlin Creek, but we did not fish because this is part of a national park, so you're not allowed to fish in there. I mention it because one of probably the most iconic rat that was ever captured was a fish from Carlin Creek. This particular color morph, which has blue in the front and orange in the back, has been only caught once by Bruce Hansen and pictured by Neil Armstrong. Nobody in the hobby had ever bred this fish in captivity. So it's a very elusive color morph, way more rare than 1%. Leo was breeding, he got some fish again from an auction, and he was breeding those fish for like 5 years. And at the time I visited, he had one male after 5 years of breeding that had a red tail. So he gave me a few fish. I think I got like three females and four males. And I feverishly was breeding this fish, hoping that I'll be lucky and have some offspring that have a little bit of red. So this is how the fish looked that I got from Leo. And I was very lucky. Indeed, I got multiple in the first generation. I got multiple fish that had red tails, like these two males that are sparring with each other. I have a few more pictures of those. So red-tailed males. This particular fish also shows the breeding, the red breeding stripe. And this particular male has even a little bit of red-orange in the anal fin. I took the fish, so I discovered that I had fish like this last spring. And of course I took males that had red tails and I was pairing them. I had two other females that had a little bit of red. So I paired up the two females with two males in a separate tub. And I was generating offspring from them, but also set up another group with just red-tailed males and blue females. And I'm now growing out the F2s from those crossings, and I can already see fish that have more red than the fish that I had in the first generation. Leah also gave me some fish that we didn't collect together. This is the Castaways Creek location. He has a very striking pattern, just like I described, this ornate pattern on the side. And then this particular location has an interesting red-brown coloration in the anal fin, and a little bit of the lower tail fin is brown as well. So I think it's a very attractive color form as well. Another location I was able to bring home was from Evans Head. Again, the striking scale pattern on the sides, and this particular male also showing the breeding stripe here. He also gave me some fish from Burring Bar. Those are fish that had not been described yet at the time he gave them to me. And from Krabby's Creek, this is an image from Gunther. And this particular fish from the Kalula location is at the top of my wish list. And hopefully at some point I'll be able to get fish from that. It's a very rare color form as well. And Leo told me that he has not been able to consistently get offspring that have this particular color form. So how does one breed rats? I'm gonna show you how I breed them indoors and outdoors. I'm not saying this is the best or only method of how to breed them. This is what I have used successfully, but I know there's a number of other methods that can be used to successfully breed these fish. So first, in order to distinguish male and female, so you could set up breeding pairs appropriately, is you look at the end of the dorsal and the anal fins. If those are pointy and elongated, like on this male, you know it's a male. And those fins are short and rounded on a female. And another breeding characteristic is when the fish turn on the breeding stripe, as shown in this Sears Creek fish and in this red color morph from the Snapper Creek variety. So when I came home in July, I was anxious to breed those fish right away because at that time I had fish that probably nobody else had in the US at that time. So I was worried that I might be losing some of them over the winter. So I started breeding them indoors. The way I did it most successfully was by putting a pair in a 10-gallon tank with lots of plants. In this case, I used Java fern, and then fry would emerge. And the fish, if you feed them well, I mostly feed them with live baby brine shrimp, they won't predate their fry. And so I'm gonna run this video so you can see that there's actually fry in this tank. So when you look at the surface up here, you can see fry swimming. So I usually let this go for a few weeks, and then the fry are big enough that they would predate newly hatching fries. I moved the adults into a new tank. So these are fry that were generated just before I moved the pair. And these were my oldest fry here. You know, they're larger in size. So by continuously moving breeding pairs from one planted tank to the next, I could basically continuously breed these fish indoors. For me, that was the most efficient and productive way of breeding them. My favorite way of breeding them is probably outdoors. Here's a setup that I had last summer. I now have even more tubs, but I was using 65 and 100 gallon Rubbermaid and other manufacturers' products tubs. I was setting them up with floating plants that had long bushy roots, so the fish would spawn in there. And what I also learned the hard way is that it's advantageous to cover those tubs with seine netting. So I was using 1/4 inch seine nettings to cover the tubs in order to prevent dragonflies from laying their eggs into the water. Dragonflies like to lay their eggs, and their nymphs would then predate your fish. I learned this the hard way, but the first year I did it, I had some blue eyes in the tub, and they were breeding just fine. But at the end of the summer, when I wanted to collect my adult fish, I couldn't find any. What I found instead was dozens of dragonfly larvae that were at the bottom of the tank. So they're highly predatory, and if you can keep them out, you have a much safer environment for your fish. I do feed my fish daily in those tubs. I give them live baby brine shrimp, but they do get a lot of extra food that's provided by the insects that are living outside. So for example, the mosquitoes can go through the 1/4 inch netting, lay their eggs, and when the larvae hatch, the fish will be able to eat them. So it's not that you have a mosquito brood here. The fish will actually eradicate every single mosquito larvae, but you will have a good food supply for the adult fish, and they will breed just well. What I have also discovered is that the fry grow much faster when you keep them outdoors. Generally, the water can be warmer during the day. If you're lucky, you get green water, and green water really accelerates the growth of the fry. Within a few weeks, you have good size fry. If you're trying to maximize production of the fry, you can net them out every 2 or 3 weeks, bring them inside and raise them inside. New fry will hatch and will not get predated by the larger fry. So you can continuously harvest fish from these tubs. These are pictures from Leo's outdoor breeding operation. He has, as I said before, he has 60 tubs set up like this in varying sizes. And he also has set up two of these round big ponds and then 12 of the IBCs. And he'll be adding another 20 of those. So these are large containers, and you can grow much larger numbers of fry in there. One of his major problems, he told me, was that the climate is warmer there than here. So actually, heat can be a problem for him. So having larger containers to breed the fish probably will help in balancing the temperature fluctuations. So this is the end of my presentation. I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
I have a question, Marcel. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Indoor breeding, what temperature do you keep your tanks at for breeding? And then is that different for the fry, or is that the same temperature?
That's a good question. Most rainbow fish I keep at the fry I keep at 82 degrees, and also I hatch the eggs at 82. This is not necessary, or actually not optimal for the rats. I keep them in the mid 70s, so like 74, 75 is an ideal temperature to keep and have them breed. And the fry will hatch just fine and can be raised at this temperature. Outdoors, of course, it's out of your control and the water gets warmer, and that's fine with the fish too. But long-term, I think it's advantageous to keep the fish at a cooler temperature than most of the rainbow fish, at least when you breed them.
Marcel?
Yes.
Can you hear me? This is Basil from New York. How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing very well. I'm interested in, I've worked with your Tiwa Creek strain, and I think I'd like to start doing some blue fish. So what would you suggest?
You want to start out with blue fish?
Yeah, I want to start working with the blues.
Well, I think that's the dominant color form. I think it should be easier to get blue fish than it is to maintain or breed red fish.
Right.
There's a number of people who have Ceres Creek fish in the hobby. And I think it should not be too hard to get fish that have more blue than red. My population of fish, they all have red tails now. And the red varies from fish to fish. But I think you can easily select back to the blue color form if you wanted to. But there's, oh, are you, I'm sorry, you're talking about Tiwa Creek. Yeah, that might be hard to get to a blue Tiwa Creek form. I haven't heard of anybody doing this. I was thinking you're talking Ceres Creek fish, but that's not the case. I guess it might be possible. I haven't heard that anybody is doing this. But if you like blue fish, I would just suggest getting another location of rats. Like most of the fish from Carlin Creek or Ceres Creek, they're still blue, so you could just work with them.
Yeah, that's what I meant. I didn't want to cross out the Tiwa Creek. I want to keep the Tiwa Creek a clean strain, and then sure. I want to start working with some blues because they're all beautiful.
Yeah, you don't want to mix them, but no. If you like blue rats, why not take a location that, you know, where the blue form is the dominant form?
Yeah, that was my question. So basically go to Ceres Creek location.
Yeah, Ceres Creek or Carlin Creek, you know, they're mostly blue at this point. So you all have the blue fish you like, or Snapper Creek, the black color, the dominant form, actually has a lot of iridescent blue. I have those in the tank behind me. So that might be an option as well.
Thank you.
So Basil, if you check your chat, Gary Lang chimed in, he can get you some in the spring.
Okay.
Yep, just wait until it gets a little bit warmer, and I've got plenty of blues in there because I brought in most of my stock from outside, so I've still got quite a bit of stock right now.
Okay. Got quite a bit of hair going there too, Gary.
Yeah, I need to shave a little bit.
Good to see you too.
So Marcel, in the picture that you have up right now on the upper left, that bronze and black fish, for want of a better terminology, do you have that strain right now or no?
So you're talking about these two fish, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so they're the Snapper Creek form. Yes, I do have them. This is the red color morph. It's the male that I showed in the video that has a lot of red. And I'm selecting for that red color form. So I do have fish. I have fish in between all the varieties, you know, fish that are mostly blue but have a little bit of red on their tail to almost being all red.
I really think that the bronze and green combination is very sharp all by itself. So,
right. It's definitely an interesting location because it harbors more than just one rare color morph. It has the green and the red and then the dominant black form.
Marcel?
Yes.
Yeah, this is Guy from New York, Basil's friend. Thanks. First of all, thanks for thinking of us and inviting us. This is quite a treat. How hard is it to bring in fish from Australia? What did you have to do?
You have to follow the regulations. You know, you have to look on the U.S. Fish and Wildlife website and see what the regulations are and just follow them.
Okay. Second question. All the males you've shown us have the red breeding stripe. Do any of them have a different color?
I have not seen a different color than red. I don't know if Gary knows if there's more variety in the breeding stripe than the red orange.
Third question is the only thing you feed them baby brine?
I mostly feed them baby brine, but they take other foods. They take frozen foods as well, frozen daphnia. They take little microworms. It's good to feed them live or frozen food. I mean, they will take flakes, but I would not want to maintain them on flakes. It's just a transient, food for them, I think.
All right.
They certainly do very well with live foods outside in the tubs.
Okay.
Hey, Guy, while you're on there, did you get your ANCFA?
Yes, journal? I did, Gary. Thank you very much.
Good. Thank you.
That's a terrific publication.
Marcel, there's a question that is asking about your tubs. What kinds of floating plants do you use in your tubs?
Anything that has an extensive root structure and is bushy, like water hyacinths, water lettuce, those will work.
Okay. I had a question too about your netting, your sand netting.
Yes.
Where do you get it and what did you use as weights around the edges I saw?
You know, it took me a little while to find them. And I think Brent and all actually was finding them on Amazon. Oh. You just go to the Amazon website and type in 1/4 inch seine netting.
Okay.
And those nettings come in different sizes. So one particular size, I think this is 8x12 here. This really worked well for me because I was able to cover 165-gallon tub, in a linear fashion. But there's smaller nettings as well. And these weights here, they come, these actual same, that you can use for fishing. They're a functional fishing net. And I just use them, I abuse them for keeping out the dragonflies, basically.
Okay. I guess I had another question. What was the orange and blue fish?
Orange and blue.
It was a rad that you showed earlier.
There's a number that, those are blue and orange. Carlin Creek are mostly blue.
That one, the super rare one.
Right. That's the Carlin Creek location.
Okay.
The fish that I got were all blue, and now I have a few that have a little bit of red, and the red seems to be increasing with selective breeding.
Okay. Do you have those available for sale?
Yeah, I have good numbers of those. I generally don't ship in the cold winter months. I can do it with heat packs, but it's just an added risk that I generally don't like to take. But, if it's getting warmer, like end of March and April, I start shipping again. But if you're a local, you can pick up fish at my house anytime.
Great.
I was about to say, that's the benefit of being in Madison.
Yeah.
Marcel, how many varieties of rainbow fish do you think you have?
Oh, I didn't tally them up.
That's like my mom always asks me, how many fish do you have?
I could tally them up, but I can't tell you, precisely offhand.
Okay. All right, well, does anyone else have any questions for Marcel? You could use the chat function or just shout out You might have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, Marcel, are you planning on bringing in any imports from Australia in the near future?
I would like to, yes. You know, you saw that email from Leo, so
yeah.
Hopefully we can put something together. We'll have to see.
Maybe wait until after they get the Gordie River up and breeding. That would be nice to get a new some new blood from there.
Right. So for the other people, Dave Wilson recently collected Gordie Rivers, so from the wild, and he's breeding them up right now. And you know, bringing in fresh blood from the wild, I think would be advantageous for the people that keep them in the hobby.
Also with Goiter River, they have to get special permission from the native landowners. You just can't go in there and grab those. So you have to get special permission. So it's a really tough thing. And he's got good connections. So Dave's the guy.
Yeah.
So when it comes to bringing them in, do they bring them in as fry or do they bring them in as eggs?
No, they're generally larger fish. You know, they're juvenile fish. If they're too small, they're not very good in surviving the transport. So generally, 1 to 2 inch fish probably.
Do we have any hope of having a convention that was going to take place in Canada last year? Is there any talk about that again?
You don't have to ask me. Gary probably knows more about that.
Okay. My understanding is that everything is going to take place in October. That's what they hope. They don't have a date yet, though, because there's still, you know, they're going to wait to see how things are going. Hopefully we get the vaccination thing going here in the United States, and they'll let us across the border. You know, we're like a third world country now, so nobody lets us into their country. So let's hope.
Okay.
Can I ask a general question about rainbows?
Sure.
These are all originally saltwater fish. Is there any genetic studies that can identify the ancestor Silverside?
I'm not aware of those kind of studies. Are you, Gary?
No, I think that goes back so far, millions and millions of years. It's, you know, that's so far back that it's not even
possible.
Possible. You know, the one thing that I've noticed as I'm traveling around New Guinea is that at one time Jerry Allen said, "Oh, the whole top part of New Guinea is Alleni, or the whole top part of New Guinea is Fasciata." And then we start going to these places and then getting DNA, you realize that they're not. The only way you get from one spot 200 miles later is to get in the ocean and swim. And these rainbow fish just don't do that. So that's why they're different species now, because they've been segregated for, you know, half a million years or a million years. So that you know, we're kind of disproving a lot of stuff that Alan thought many years ago.
Yeah. So as Australia moved north, the temperature and cold water fish, like the Galaxids, were forced south, and that opened up the northern warmer waters for the saltwater fish. Is that the way it worked?
I guess so. I can't comment on that for sure.
Hey, Marcel, thank you for the excellent presentation. I'm just setting up some bins outside. I'm in Florida, same kind of climate as Leo's in, and I think his solution to the heat was larger volume, which I'm not capable of doing. So what's the upper limit of the temperature for rainbows outside, where the danger zone starts?
Well, this is not something that we have to worry about here in Wisconsin. It doesn't get that hot. You probably have to ask Leo about that. You know, one other way he told me that he copes with warm temperature, I think he's using panels for fridges or cold rooms, and then he covers the tops of his tanks with that. So, you know, he can reduce the amount of heat that the water will absorb over the course of the day.
You mean insulation?
Yeah, it's some like insulation material that is typically used for coolers or fridges.
Okay, thanks.
Why didn't he dig them into the ground?
I guess that's a possibility. It's a little bit of work if you have 60 or 100 of those to dig in.
Yeah. Just three.
Oh, yes, okay.
That was my original plan. So I may be going with that, just partially dig them.
Well, yeah, I know that Gary has a pond that he has dug in. Maybe you could talk about that.
I put mine halfway in and halfway out. That way I get the warmth, but I also get that solar cooling. The other thing that somebody had told me here in Missouri years ago, they had a above ground pool and it was 95 degrees when I was visiting. He said, stick your hand under the lily pads, and it was 75 under there. So if you cover, you only want to cover at most half of your pond with lily pads, but those will reflect the heat also. So that might be a choice for you down in Florida.
Yeah, what I actually see with my tubs is the tub water is warm, and that's where the fry would naturally be because they're, you know, looking for food at the surface. But the breeders are typically in much deeper water. They only come up for spawning. So I presume it's much colder in the lower parts of the tub.
We have had a request to see your fish room. Is it possible? I mean, his fish room's huge, so I think that would be like a whole video unto itself, but maybe to take your camera and just sort of show a little bit of your fish room?
Well, it's not a mobile camera, you know, it's attached to the computer with a USB port, so I can't just walk around like I would like to.
Okay, great. Well, thank you. Anyway, and if you come to Cataclysm in October, you might get a chance to look at Marcel's fish room, so there's a plug for that.
Yeah, I'll open it up and I'd be happy to entertain people.
Given whether the pandemic is under control or not.
Yes.
Well, this has been a wonderful talk, Marcel. And actually we had the highest attendance of any of our talks so far since we went to the online format, 40 people. I jotted down as many names as I could, so I'll send that to you. And if anybody has any friends that are interested in seeing this talk, I will put it on Vimeo, and then I'm going to put it a link on our website and our Facebook page.
Thanks again, Marcel.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thanks for hosting me, and thanks for joining, Gary.
Yeah, thank you, everybody who came. This has been great.
Great talk, Marcel.
Thanks, Marcel.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Marcel.
Thanks, Marcel.
Nice job.